Well, while that last video was rendering, I went and looked up the rules of craps, and this isn't even close. There are a lot of rules. I was reading all the different things. There are many rules. So, anyway, let's continue on with this example, though. In this game, that I will, instead of calling Monopoly, maybe I should call it 7 and 11, because if you roll a 7 or 11, you win, and then otherwise you lose. That's the name of our game. Now, remember that what we're talking about here is object-oriented programming. As this program stands, it's something we call procedural programming. We've just written everything in one big method. It's not compartmentalized at all. And this is the way that we used to program. It is writing everything just all in one file, and that would be the program. The problem is this. My father, who's been an educator for a long, long time, he likes to talk about object-oriented programming in terms of time and space. That the reason we use object-oriented programming is because of time and space. And what he means by that is two things. I'm going to look at space first. If I come to this to you with this program, now it took me 15 minutes to write this program. All right. If I came to you and said, look, 15 minutes was a long time to write this program. I want you to do it as a team. And so I want two of you to work on this program. So if I were to take this program and give it to you and I say, I want you to work as a partner on this program, how would you divide up the duties? That sounded like duties. That's funny. No, duties with a T. How would you divide up the duties? Who would do what? Now, this is just a silly example because this is such a small program. If we would just sat down and wrote it straight out, we could write it really fast, right? But in other examples, most programming these days occurs in teams because a team can accomplish a lot in a very short period of time relative to what it would take one person writing that program to write that program, right? And because we're always in the programming world trying to crank stuff out really fast, then a lot of times we work in this team environment. This is just the nature of programming. And so if we had to divide this up, there are two major concepts. One is this idea of rolling the dice, right? And then there's kind of this other concept wrapped around it of looking at the total and deciding whether, how many wins and losses there were, and then printing that result. And those are the two kind of concepts in it, but how do I divide that up into teamwork? The only way to really do it if we're working on the same file is for one person to do their part and then pass it to the other person to do their part. Or, I suppose, we could get both people to do their parts individually and then copy and paste the code in. But that's obviously not a great solution either because of the problems that come with copying and pasting, and you don't know what variables have been used, and it creates a mess that way. So you wouldn't want to do that. So how do we do it? And so one of the problems, one of the major problems that object-oriented programming solves, that hopefully will help you to understand why we do it this way, because what it's going to feel like initially is it takes longer to do it this way. It's more of a pain to do it this way. Why don't we just do it the old way? But hopefully you'll understand why we do it this way, and one of the reasons is space. Meaning, how many people can we get crowded around a keyboard to work on a program? Well, really, only one person can work on a keyboard at one time, right? And so, in order to be able to fit more people into doing the program, then we do this in an object-oriented manner. So, let me kind of demonstrate how we do that. The dice roll is something that might be used in many programs again and again. So, maybe I'll create an object, so I'll call this public class dice, okay, and that's the name of the class. This is going to be the dice class. And then we can say public static void. Well, no, sorry. I'm heading down a path here I didn't want to go down. I just autopilot there for a second. This object that I'm creating is not going to be a driver class. So I was going to write the main method here. But this is not going to be used as a main method. This dice is not the object that's going to be doing the acting. And you'll get all this as we get in a little bit further. But this is just something to be used. Okay? So public class dice, and we're going to create a method called roll the dice. Okay, so I'm going to create a public method that's going to return. Now remember, normally we'd put a void here, but instead we're going to just put an int, because I'm going to return the number that was rolled, and I'll call this method roll the dice, or maybe just roll dice. And notice there's no static here, because this isn't anything that belongs to the calling class. It's going to belong to the object. And do we need them to pass anything into us? Well, for now, let's not have them pass anything. Okay. So I'm creating a method called roll the dice. And all I'm going to do here is the functionality that I did here in order to be able to roll that dice. So I'm going to import the java.util.random class. Whoops. And then inside this method, I will create let's do it inside the method. I'll create this random r equals new random. Okay, so I've got this random number generator that I'm creating. And then I'm going to create a roll, so I'll integer roll, and I'll set it equal to 0 to begin with. And then I can actually roll that number. So I'll set roll equal to r.nextInt, and the next int is out of how many? Well, it's going to be the exact same thing, out of 6. And add 1 onto it, which will give me a number between 1 and 6. Okay, so I now have that roll. So I can make a little comment here, simulate the roll of the die. And then I can return that roll. Okay, now remember, just as a review, that when we are creating a method, this section, these parentheses are used to pass information to us. And again, we could be passing in an int x and an int y and a string z. We can pass in all this different information using these parentheses. We can only return one thing, and this defines the type. So if I was passing back a string, that would be a string. If I was passing back a double, this would be a double, but in this case it's an integer that I'm passing back. And so that defines when they call the roll dice method, they can't pass anything in. They don't need to, and they can't. And what we're going to give back to them is an integer. Okay, so I've created this dice class now, and its whole purpose in life is to simulate the roll of a dice, or a die, individual die. Okay? All right, so then what I'm going to do is create a second class, and this part, so one person could be working on this dice part, and the other person could be working on public class Spencer's Dumb Game. Okay, so Spencer's Dumb Game is that if we get a 7 or 11, we win, otherwise we lose. Okay? And so this one is going to be kind of running the show. So this will have the public static void main method, string args. Okay. And so this one is going to be the one that has the int for roll or die1, int die2, set equal to 0. And then it's going to have the functionality for the roll, or simulate the roll. Roll of the die. Dice 1,000 times. Okay, so that'll have that for loop. For an int I equals 1, while I is less than or equal to 1,000, I plus plus. So there's the number of times. Oh, and we forgot to get our total variable and our numbers of wins and losses. So int total, and set that equal to 0, and then I'll have an int for the num wins. That's 0. Int for the num losses. That's 0. Okay, so we've got the functionality here to keep track of this game, right? And I'll even build in the if statement. If the total that we roll is equal to a 7, or the total is equal, is equal to an 11, then we're going to system.out.println. We don't want to print. We want to increase the number of wins, right? Sorry about that. And then have an else statement. Num losses. Okay. So that's what's going on in this program so far. Now, what we're missing here is so this is deciding the outcome, but we're missing the rolling the dice, right? And then let me put in the last part, after our for loop. So this is the end of the for. After the end of the for loop, that's where we print out and say, wins, and we can concatenate on the number of wins. Losses, and then we concatenate on the number of losses, right? Okay, so this is basically like our other program. The only part we're missing is the simulation of the roll of the die, which we've now passed off to another object that's going to take care of that for us. Okay? And so we'll look at how we do that. Let's see. Yeah, we've got all that information in there. I like to keep these videos to 15 minutes or less. So to run into this next thought, I don't think I'll have time to get in there. So I'm going to go ahead and end this, and then we'll pick up in the next video. Okay? Spencer out.